Hi, I'm Bob Herbert. Welcome to op-ed.tv. Antisemitism in the United States has surged dramatically in the wake of the horrific terror attacks in Israel by Hamas and Israel's months-long retaliation. The surge has included unprovoked physical attacks against Jewish individuals, violent threats and harassment of Jews on college campuses, boycotts and protests at Jewish-owned businesses, bomb threats and vandalism at synagogues, and public demonstrations with hate-filled anti-Jewish chants, signs, and other forms of vitriol. Much of this bigoted behavior has come from people on the left who in other circumstances have condemned racism and bigotry and who frankly ought to know better. As Senator Chuck Schumer said in an impassioned speech on the Senate floor, quote, "Many of us marched together for black and brown lives. We stood against anti-Asian hatred. We protested bigotry against the LGBTQ community. We fought for reproductive justice out of the recognition that injustice against one oppressed group is injustice against all." But apparently, in the eyes of some, this principle does not extend to the Jewish people. Close quote. I will talk about all of this with my guest, Scott Richman, the regional director of the Anti-Defamation League of New York and New Jersey. Scott, welcome. Thanks for coming in. I appreciate it.
Thanks so much for having me.
So maybe we can start by making it clear that criticism of Israel or Benjamin Netanyahu or Israeli policies is not inherently anti-Semitic. But many of the protests and much of the criticism and related behavior that we've been seeing is without question anti-Semitic. A lot of it has gone way over the line. Can you talk a little bit about the distinction?
Sure. So certainly you're correct. Criticism of Israel is not anti-Semitic. There's nothing wrong with criticizing Israel. There's nothing wrong with criticizing the United States. I mean, that should be clear. You can look at the protesters who spent the better part of 2023 protesting Israel, Israeli protesters.
In Israel.
In Israel, right. The judicial reform that Netanyahu mm-hmm. was trying to put in place. You would not call these people anti-Semitic. In fact, you may call them particularly pro-Israel. They're concerned about the state, and they do it out of love for the state. So the issue is not whether or not criticism of Israel is anti-Semitic. The issue is when it rises to the level of anti-Semitism. And here we use the International Holocaust Remembrance Alliance definition of anti-Semitism as a guideline. This is the most widely accepted definition and adopted by many countries. And it talks about the three Ds: delegitimization, demonization, and double standard. Mm-hmm. When you delegitimize the state, when you say it has no right to exist, that means that criticism is rising to the level of anti-Semitism. When you demonize the state, when you call it some sort of evil entity, compare it to the actions of the Nazis, that could rise to the level of anti-Semitism. And when you apply a double standard, a standard that you may not apply to any other country, that could rise to the level of anti-Semitism. Always taken into account context, but these are the benchmarks.
So Senator Chuck Schumer from New York made an extraordinary impassioned speech on the Senate floor, very unusual for Chuck. I've known him for decades. It was a 40-minute speech, and he said that this surge in anti-Jewish hatred in the United States is a crisis. He described it as a five-alarm fire. Now, I mentioned in the introduction some of the forms that this hatred has taken, but can you give us a bit of a fuller picture of what's been going on since October 7th?
Absolutely. So I can tell you that ADL, as part of our work, we do incident response. We respond to anti-Semitic incidents that are reported to us or that we are made aware of. Since October 7th, year over year, compared to 2022, that has gone up over 300%. My office, I'm the director for New York and New Jersey, I can tell you that we are overwhelmed with incidents. We've been overwhelmed with incidents since October 7th.
Two liberal states.
Yes, for sure. Well, New York and New Jersey have the distinction of having more anti-Semitic incidents than almost any other state across the nation. New York always number one, and New Jersey has been wavering between number two and number three for a long time. So that's clear, and that was before October 7th. It just continues. And I can say we're comparing to 2022, but 2022 was the highest year on record since ADL has been keeping track of anti-Semitic incidents, which is since 1979. So we're comparing to a really tough year. The end of the year in 2022 was the time of Kanye West and Kyrie Irving. Right. There were a lot of copycat incidents, a lot of incidents. So we're comparing to a year that was a high. We can talk about the fact that just before October 7th, it was a really tough period. It was a period of swatting of Jewish institutions where there were bomb threats and threats of gunmen in the synagogue or in the Jewish community center or in the school that were called in hopes of creating chaos. For months, we were dealing with this. Jewish community was already on edge before October 7th, and certainly since October 7th, that has continued to play out. And we've seen this, as the senator said, really an explosion of anti-Semitic incidents.
Now, you mentioned just before we came on the air that there had been a demonstration against Senator Schumer, I believe at his daughter's house, and also demonstrations and or attacks aimed at other office holders. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Sure. So Senator Schumer, who has been very strong on Israel's right to defend itself, has been accused by a group of committing genocide, of being a baby killer, and they got, as they would say, a tip that he was going to be at his daughter's apartment for Shabbat dinner, honoring Shabbat, a special dinner on Friday night. And they stood in front of the apartment building this past Friday, and they were protesting him and calling him a baby killer and guilty of genocide.
And then,
of course, you mentioned the other office holders.
Right.
So Dan Goldman and Congressman Lawler, Congressman Goldman, they have all experienced their offices being graffitied. This is a tough moment for these congresspeople who are standing up for Israel's right to defend itself. But, of course, they do not waver just because of graffiti.
Now, you made the point that we were already in a tough period before last October 7th in terms of anti-Semitism in the U.S. And, of course, it's intensified tremendously since then. But taking it all into account, what do you think is the reasons or are the reasons for the basis for this continued surge and intensifying surge in hatred against Jews in America?
Look, it seems pretty clear. These are people who are blaming Jews in this country for what's happening in Israel. They're upset about what's happening in Israel. I'm upset about what's happening in Israel. I'm upset about the loss of innocent lives. But these are people who are blaming the Jews in this country and blaming other supporters for what's happening in Israel. It's the support of the Jews in this country, the support of the government, and that's what they're angry about, and they're taking it out on the Jewish community.
You know, we might mention that, again, before October 7th, we had the terrible attack at the Tree of Life Synagogue in Pittsburgh, in which 11 people were killed. I mean, so.
Right. I mean, look, we should be clear that many of the incidents that we're talking about are speech-related. There are instances of assault. I believe since October 7th, we counted something like 56 incidents of assault. So there are violent attacks. But most of these are speech-related. The issue is when you put out such rhetoric, when you blame the Jewish community for all types of things, there is the chance that one crazy, unhinged person is going to come along, going to believe it, going to believe that the Jewish community is nefarious and an entity that needs to be stopped. In the case of what happened in Tree of Life, that was all kinds of rhetoric about immigration.
Yeah.
And this person, I remember his name, but I'm not going to mention his name. This person heard this. And the week before, there was some sort of solidarity Shabbat with refugees. This person saw that and said, this is a synagogue that needs to be attacked. You just need one person to act on what they're hearing. And that's the big fear here, that somebody's going to hear this kind of rhetoric. You know, this over the past few weeks, there was a big controversy. Why was there a big controversy? Because there were statements made about Zionists.
Right.
This idea that Zionist doctors could not properly treat black and brown people. That's a horrific notion. It's essentially saying that Jews in this country are not capable of fairly treating black and brown people because of, I guess, whatever biased notions
right.
they have. It's awful. The vast majority of Jews in this country see Israel as an integral piece of their identity. That's been shown by the Pew study. This is not about ADL surveys. This is the Pew study that said that, over 80%. That means that they are Zionists. To be a Zionist simply means that you believe in the right of the state of Israel to exist. If you're saying that for some reason, if you're a Zionist, you can't treat black and brown people properly, and it doesn't have to do with medicine. You
right.
know, it could be you're their accountant or their lawyer or their shopkeeper or whatever it happens to be. That's a horrific statement about the Jewish community. And you saw that a professor at UC San Francisco, she lifted up this statement. UC San Francisco immediately condemned it in the most vociferous terms. But that's the concern, that Jews in this country are being blamed for what's happening in Israel.
And of course, when you mention something like this statement about Zionist doctors, for example, it immediately makes me think of the days of Jim Crow, when white hospitals and white doctors would not treat black people. And now, you know, I don't know how we get to a position like this, but it just
right.
seems crazy.
Crazy.
To me.
Crazy.
So.
And especially the Jewish community. Jewish community that fought for civil rights and believes so much and partners so much. Certainly my organization partners an incredible amount with not just the black community, but all marginalized groups. That's our work.
Which was one of Schumer's points.
We fight hate.
Right.
And, you know, and not just anti-Semitism, but all forms of hate. And the idea that we would somehow not be treating fairly groups of people, especially marginalized people, is really completely anathema to our DNA.
A big story recently was the appearance of three elite university college presidents before a congressional hearing, in which they were each asked, and actually not just in passing, but they were pursued on this issue, about whether calls for the genocide of Jews would violate the rules of conduct at their schools and therefore result in student discipline. And the presidents of Harvard, the University of Pennsylvania, and MIT had all kinds of trouble answering that question. They gave evasive answers, essentially saying it would depend on the context in which these calls for genocide were made.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't take long for the repercussions to play out. Penn's president, Elizabeth McGill, resigned 4 days later. The resignation of Harvard's Claudine Gay soon followed along. There had been questions also about her academic credentials. As of this taping, the president of MIT, Sally Kornblath, still has her job. My question is, what's your take or ADL's take on this whole controversy? What was your initial response? And do you think those presidents should have lost their jobs?
So first of all, in the interest of being completely open and transparent, I'm a graduate of Penn, so I have a vested interest
in
all of this. My alma mater, but of course, President McGill was a new president, as was President Gay. Unfortunately, these new presidents are probably particularly nervous about their positions and
right.
unsure of how to behave. I think they got a lot of advice that sort of kept them very focused on a particular set of talking points.
Lawyers and crisis counselors, yeah.
Whoever it was. And, you know, the question was a fairly simple one. And whether or not you wanted to take into account context, at the very least, condemning the idea of calling for the genocide of anybody, not just the Jewish community on your campus, needed to be a part of your rhetoric in that moment. And really sticking so blindly to the talking points, I think, of course, is what got them in trouble. You know, in terms of our perspective on whether or not they should have resigned, I mean, that's a question for the university community, the board. But I do think that there should have been consequences for sure. Consequences for not having immediately condemned the idea of genocide against any group and immediately saying that there has to be some sort of violation of the code of conduct if you're calling for genocide of a group on campus.
Yeah, so many people have said, you know, suppose they were calling for the genocide of blacks, or suppose they were calling for the genocide of Catholics or something. That, you
right.
know, it's hard to believe that they would have so much trouble answering the question. It was actually baffling to me. I do understand that it's difficult. They probably were nervous or whatever, but it's a question that you should be able to answer.
Right. Also, like genocide, the word genocide becomes a little bit cheapened this moment.
That becomes a problem.
And the same with the International Court of Justice and the suit that's being brought against the State of Israel. Like, even the calling for the murder of somebody, genocide is like the absolute top of the pyramid here. You're calling for the obliteration of a people, but even calling for the murder of somebody, right. I would think, violates the code of conduct of the universe.
Right. But if you just toss the word around willy-nilly, it
right.
loses its power, and then you hear it, and you don't really understand what it means. It's like, seriously?
Right. I mean, we're hearing it constantly, accusations against Israel. It's a very, very serious accusation. Which, of course, is completely wrong and a fallacy,
yeah.
the idea right. that Israel is committing
right.
genocide.
Right. Right. So Senator Schumer expressed a sense of betrayal when he was talking about people who were Democrats or who were on the left or people that he and his allies have marched and supported, passed legislation in support of it, et cetera. But he also said, and this was interesting, he said that anti-Semites are taking advantage of the pro-Palestinian movement to espouse hatred and bigotry toward Jewish people, and that some otherwise well-meaning liberals, and especially young people, were unwittingly or unknowingly aiding and abetting their cause. Do you agree that some of the anti-Semitism that we're seeing, if you're talking about demonstrations or if you're talking about protests or whatever, do you think that some of it is unwitting or based on ignorance? And if so, how should we be responding to that?
For sure. I mean, this is an extremist group, Hamas, a terrorist group declared by the U.S. You know, if the tables were turned and this were a group of Jewish extremists who had committed this act, I would be the first person to stand up against them. The idea of seeing this group of people as being part of the general Palestinian cause for sovereignty is completely inappropriate. The general Palestinian cause for sovereignty is about pushing for a two-state solution.
Right.
Hamas does not believe in a two-state solution. They believe in wiping Israel off the map and having essentially a one-state solution, but only with Palestinians. This is a binary that I don't subscribe to. The binary is that either you are with Israel or you are with the Palestinians. And I think that people who are perhaps well-meaning do not understand that that's not what this is about. This
right.
is about a group of extremists, and we all need to stand up to extremism. I'm an avowed Zionist. I will say it. I believe in Israel's right to exist. That's the definition of Zionism. It has nothing to do with whether or not I'm critical of Israel. I could be incredibly critical or incredibly supportive of Israel. That's not what Zionism is about. Zionism is about just believing in Israel's right to exist. I'm an avowed Zionist, and I believe in a two-state solution, but I also am pro-Palestinian. I believe in the rights of the Palestinian people, and the idea of a two-state solution is important to me. It's important to my organization. And this notion that you are either one or the other is a completely false binary.
Hamas has taken or does not believe in a two-state solution. They're not in favor of a two-state solution. But Benjamin Netanyahu has made it clear that he doesn't favor a two-state solution either. That, of course, is not a justification for anti-Semitic behavior. But in terms of addressing the issue that's going on in Israel, it is problematic to a great degree. And not only that, there's been all the controversy over the phrase "from the river to the sea" used by Hamas, by Palestinians, by many of the protesters and that sort of thing. But Netanyahu again has said that Israel has to have absolute security from the Jordan River to the Mediterranean Sea, from the river to the sea. would you agree that, again, it's not a justification for anti-Semitic behavior, but would you agree that that stance by Netanyahu and the hardliners in Israel is really complicates the situation and, of course, not helpful at all here in the United States?
So, look, Netanyahu has made clear statements in the past that he is in favor of a Palestinian state under the right circumstances. His statements now about the ability to engage in a process towards a two-state solution is, of course, colored by the current situation, by a situation which is really fraught in terms of security needs. I would hope that we would get past this. I would hope that we would begin to move to a point where we can begin to trust one another to some extent. But I understand Israel's security needs in the moment with terrorists on their borders who are looking to do incredible harm to the state.
But if you're in a situation with someone you know, someone you care about, and you're talking, and these are folks who, for example, are genuinely appalled by the plight of civilian Palestinians, some of whom, many of whom have been killed, and relatives who have lost relatives, and children who have died, and that sort of thing. And yet, in their discussions, they cross over into anti-Semitic comments or tropes or that sort of thing. How should they be confronted? If these are people that you know, that you care about, maybe relatives, how do you get them to understand that this is wrong, and not just wrong, but potentially very dangerous? How do you begin to get that across?
So first of all, you need to be clear that loss of innocent life on both sides is horrific. Innocent civilians who are suffering because they've been displaced, innocent civilians who are suffering because they've been injured, and of course families of these innocent civilians who are suffering as well. So making sure that that point is clear, because I think there are a lot of accusations out there of people who are saying, you don't care about this side or that side. So that sort of empathy, I think, is something that we lack. And it will disarm the other person for sure. Very important, and of course it's well-intentioned. When I say it, I mean it. Secondly, when you have that conversation, you need to explain that kind of behavior, moving into anti-Semitic tropes, has led to violence against Jews for thousands of years. You know, we talk about the different types of tropes that there are, the trope of influence, that Jews are unduly powerful or influential, trope of greed, dual loyalty, that they're not loyal to the U.S., they're loyal to Israel, Holocaust denial. There are seven tropes, actually. And these seven tropes are conspiracy theories that have developed over thousands of years as Jews lived and as a minority among other populations. And when you live as a minority among other populations, you are othered. And these conspiracy theories developed over thousands of years. But it doesn't start with, or it doesn't end with just the conspiracy theory. It starts with a conspiracy theory. It starts with stereotypes. It starts with discrimination. But then it leads to more systemic discrimination and ultimately to violence. If you're having this conversation with somebody, letting them know that what they've just said is not an isolated statement. It's not in a vacuum. It's part of a pattern. It's part of a pattern that has led to violence against Jews for millennia. And they have to be careful with their words. You can make a statement that's focused very directly on a particular situation. But when you veer into anti-Semitic tropes, then you are part of that set of conspiracy theories that has led to violence. We talk about the pyramid of hate. And hate doesn't start at the top. Let's call that genocide or the Holocaust. It starts at the bottom with those kinds of stereotypes. We can't let it move up the pyramid.
We've only got about a minute left. I don't envy you guys at ADL. You have to deal with this, and you have to try and find solutions. You guys document the instances of anti-Semitism, whether it's violent behavior or whether it's words or protests or whatever. Talk about what your agency does and what are you doing now in essentially a crisis atmosphere?
So we definitely document and we put out our audit of anti-Semitic incidents and we let people know. We have the data to be able to drive policy. That's important. But we also respond to anti-Semitic incidents. Literally every day my staff is responding to incidents on campuses, on social media, in workplaces, in K-12 schools, wherever it happens to be. Very important part of our work. We are working closely with victims and law enforcement. That is crucial. But it's not just about that kind of reactive response. It's also about being proactive through advocacy or through education. ADL is an enormous provider of anti-bias, anti-bullying, anti-hate education, Holocaust education, anti-Semitism education in the schools, in corporations. For us, it's about being proactive. It's about creating a world where people respect one another, where they celebrate difference and celebrate diversity. Over the past year, more than 4 million students were touched by those programs. It's a big piece of what we do in this country to create a better future.
We're going to have to stop there. Scott, thanks so much for coming in. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
We've been talking with Scott Richman, who is the regional director of the Anti-Defamation League of New York and New Jersey. I'm Bob Herbert. Thanks for watching. And we'll see you next time.